confess.
I believe and confess.
As I'll be taught the word of God today. Say
my mind.
You'll be fruitful. Say
my spirit.
You'll be alive. Come on, say
my body.
You'll be in health. Come on, say
my understanding.
You produce results.
Say
my life.
You'll be changed.
You'll be charged. Be transformed. I'll not be the same again. In Jesus' mighty name we pray.
Amen.
Let's celebrate Jesus. He's a mighty God.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Amen. Lord. I hope, can we suspend everything, please? I hope I will not bore you with my lifestyle. Naturally, I'm somebody, I like strategies a lot. I like training. Not just that, I love to pray. I like to strategize too. And some of these teachings that I'm giving us is a new church, is a new plant. I believe that some of us here are the foundation of this new vision. And the reason why you find a lot of big visions when a church suddenly grows, praise the name of the Lord. I'll give you an example of what I'm talking about. If you have a very strong structure, like the church I pastored in Nigeria, there was a time all of a sudden we suddenly have a lot of people that can preach. I mean a lot of people that can preach. And sometimes like that, I traveled out for 1 month, for 2 months. I remember one December I traveled out and I gave a lot of people opportunity to preach. There couldn't be, you can feel some tension, but the tension never manifested into carnality. Why? Because by the wisdom of God, I put in some structures. Praise the name of the Lord. Mm-hmm. So it's important that as we are now, at this stage, we put in those structures so that when people join us, they will see the structure and nobody can alter the structure. And I pray that everyone will continue to build the spirit in Jesus' name.
Amen.
This is the third in the series. I'm sure, I remember that Justin and Michelle were not part of the first one, so I'm still going to take you through there. But this is the second in the series, and it's on strategy for effective spiritual leadership. So just what I want to show you is the structure that I believe can help our church to maintain the growth that we are trusting God for. Praise the name of the Lord.
Hallelujah.
What is my scripture PowerPoint? Matthew chapter 17, verse 17 and 1 to 2 talks about the leadership structure of Jesus. I'll start with Jesus' leadership structure. Jesus, if you go back to the beginning of the stride, you see that we have, I don't know if you know how to play chess, and you know that in chess, Bramane was explaining it to me, that you have to protect the king. Praise the name of the Lord. It's at the center of the game. But you have the knight, you have the queen, what else?
Bishop.
You have the pawns. They would have the pawns. That looks very, you know, scary. Praise the name of the Lord. So if you, I'm very sure that an average reader of the Bible does not really know that Jesus had a very strong structure. The structure of Jesus Christ starts from himself, and then there's a tree, followed by three guys that knows more than the others. How many of you know that? Look at Matthew chapter 17, verse 1 to 2. There are three guys that knows more than the others. He led them into experiences that others don't know about. Praise the name of the Lord.
Amen.
In Matthew chapter 17, verse 1 to 2, if you find it, you can quickly read it for us.
Now after 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James, and John.
Everybody say Peter, James, and John.
Peter, James, and John.
Say it again. Peter, James, and John. Those are the inner core. So you ask yourself, why didn't he take the 12? To experience the transfiguration. Because that information is only for the three. Only the three can handle it. Only the three have been trained, have been groomed by Jesus to have access to those kind of informations. So Jesus' leadership started with himself as the first. and followed by three apostles, Peter, James, and John. It will interest you also to know that following the three is 12, which is common to everyone. If you look at chapter 10, verse 1, Matthew chapter 10, verse 1. Matthew chapter 10, verse 1.
It's
12 disciples. So the next in the structure of the leadership of Jesus is 12. Following the 12 in the structure of the leadership of Jesus is the 70. It's only when you study the synoptic gospel that you see that their pattern is consistent. Look at Luke chapter 10, verse 1 to 2. Following the structure is the 70.
After these things, the Lord appointed other 70.
Other 70. And look at the exploit of the 70 in verse 17. Look at what the 70 did in verse 17. In that same chapter of the scripture.
And the 70 returned.
With joy. Saying, Lord, even the devils are subject.
Even the devils were subject unto us. So it wasn't only the three that were casting out devils that were healing the sick. It wasn't only the 12 that were casting out devils that were healing the sick. The 70 were doing that. Imagine that we have the pastor of this church. Imagine that we have three other ministers that are closer to the pastor. Imagine that we have 12 that are next to the three. Imagine that we have 70 people that can do healing and deliverance in this city.
Amen.
Imagine it. Just imagine it for a second. You know that the pastor will sleep more. And if you two know how to do healing and deliverance, you will sleep more. Am I right?
Yeah.
Because if the one cannot do it, you can tell three to do it. If the three cannot do it, you can tell the 12 to do it. And when the 12 are tired, 70, it's your turn. You thought that is the end, but there was another 120. In Acts of the Apostles chapter 1 verse 15, we had, by the time he left, they can at least have 120 who tarry to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. So that's the leadership structure of Jesus Christ. And you see that from that 120, by the time Peter preached in Acts chapter 2, 3,000 got born again. By the time he preached in Acts chapter 3, 5,000 got born again. And on and on and on and on, and the church exploded. Exploded to the extent that what God started in Acts chapter 1, verse 8, are you with me? Scattered all over the world in Acts chapter 8, verse 1. God did not destroy what it started. Are you with me? Follow the pattern. What God started in Acts chapter 1, verse 8, exploded to the point that the hope from Jerusalem people went all over the world in Acts chapter 8, verse 1. In the leadership structure of Moses, we saw the same pattern. We have Moses, we have Joshua, and we have the 120 elders. So what is the leadership structure of this church? I just want you to be familiar with the fact that the Redeemed Christian Church of God, Beautiful Place Parish, we are not existing in isolation. The Redeemed Christian Church of God has presence in 196 or 197 nations. And the church has a general overseer in the person of Pastor Iye Adeboye. Fortunately for us, the headquarters is in Nigeria, and in the headquarters, which is like a campground, some of us have visited the place, and if you have not, I pray that you visit it one of these days. Fortunately, you know I did something that was strange. I wasn't a member of Redeem, but before I came here, I was taking my daughters to Redeem. I don't know why. We're just visiting the place every month for prayers. So in that campground alone, millions can gather, but I was told that 500 people gather every month for the Holy Ghost service. 500,000 people gather every month. Praise the name of the Lord. It's a very big camp. Very, very big camp with houses and hotels and accommodation. It's like a city on its own. And that's where the overseer resides. And the church has thousands of parishes all over the world. So the church is structured from, you can just Google www.rccg.org. Then you see an overview of the Redeemed Christian Church of God. And then we have the regional level, which is focusing on the Australia Pacific region. It has its own overseer too, which is Pastor Abraham Astro. Then at the national level, we didn't just exist in isolation. I came into New Zealand. I wasn't a member of Redeem, but the church has been in existence in Auckland for more than... Okay, at the regional level, sorry, thank you for helping me. That's good to have to mother too. At the regional level, we have the Australia Pacific, and then we have the
South Pacific
that has New Zealand, which is owned overseer as Pastor Ibukun Williams, and all the islands, the Samoans, the Tongas, all those islands, the Redeemed Christian Church of God is there. It's easy because the overseer is an intelligent man, finished with first class and has mathematics. So you can see the way he structured the church with his intelligence, not just Holy Spirit alone. It's an intelligent man. So, and then we have the national, which comes from Auckland, that has been in New Zealand for a long time, for almost how many years? Tofumi's dad is one of the elders in the Auckland church. So you see that Tofumi practically, how old were you when you came into this New Zealand? 7 years old. And you just went into Redeem from that time, right? So the Auckland church is how old? Almost 20 years. So they've been in existence, they have a very, they have their own property. I pray that God will bless us with that in Jesus' name. And then, moving from the Auckland, you know, in New Zealand, we have been able, we have about four churches now, two in Auckland, one in Whangarei, and then another one in
Whanganui
and Whangarei. Okay, making five. We have Discovery Center in Auckland, we have the Victory House, and then we have the beautiful place parish in Christchurch. And but we are unique, celebrate us. Praise the name of the Lord. So from the parish level, now this is where the vision has not crystallized, but this is the vision I used in the church I pastored in Nigeria. I knew that leadership is an important part of church growth. So the Lord, I began to pray at that time, and God said there are three ministries that are very important to a church, which is ministry to saints, so that nobody will feel left behind in the church. Ministry to sinners and ministry to administrative ministry is very, very important. Somebody must be doing the typing. Somebody must be doing the mails. The person that is praying may not be able to do the mails. And we must keep ministering to sinners. We must keep ministering to saints. So under the administrative structure, we have the follow-up team. They are not well structured. They are not well formed, but we will form them in Jesus' name. Followed then the administration. And then the finance. Presently now, we have two people helping us in this regard, which is Sharon and Tofumi. Sharon has been here, but finished her master's, went to Auckland, went to Wellington. She's working, but she's still preparing the account of the church. She's doing very wonderful. She was one playing the drum set before. And then Tofumi has been helping us start in the gap for the follow-up and admin, and I support her with the follow-up. So when you look at ministry to saints, what are the components of ministry to saints? Which is MS1. What are the components of ministry to saints? The first component of ministry to saints is gender-based fellowship. Some people will come to our church not because of the way I preach. Some people may not even need the deliverance. Some people may not even need healing. But some people want their children to encounter Jesus. Some people want their youth to encounter Jesus. Some people just want to come and hear Romanel sing and worship. So it's important that we have a very broad mind in order to have a church that can accommodate all. There's something in church world that is called, everybody write it down, seeker-sensitive services. Seeker-sensitive services. Seeker-sensitive service. There are a lot of people in town that are seeking different things. They need different things when it comes to... When you talk about church, somebody thinks of healing. When you talk about church, somebody thinks of deliverance. When you talk about church, what Mitchell is doing is what somebody wants. warmness, food, fellowship. So all those things are very, very important in a church. So we need to structure ourselves so that every seeker, we are sensitive to their need. Every seeker, we are sensitive to their need. So the gender-based fellowship is very, very important. The children, I'm telling you, if you have someone like Abu said, and the parents are not so religious, they are not so close to God, and then by adventure they wander into our service once, and then they go back home, and for the first time Abu said quoted the Bible passage, would they come next Sunday? They want to come. They want to find out that church where their son for the first time was able to memorize the Bible passage. Is it the work of the pastor? No. The pastor misses in the children's church did that. Praise the name of the Lord.
Hallelujah.
If a youth has been a fighting bully and all of a sudden attend our youth fellowship one day and go back home and became very gentle and wasn't fighting again, would they want to find out who was behind it? The youth pastors. Who have been able to minister Christ to them. And then we have the couples fellowship. You all know, people start married and then in January and before December they pack it up. So that's one area that we don't want to leave behind too. And then we have the community study groups, which is the Bible study groups. For this, we need 10. And we are not talking about online fellowship. We are talking about physical fellowship. Praise the name of the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Then we have the ministries and department groups. We have the choir. I thank God for Brother Justin helping us, you know, to stand as usher. Some people just want a smile when they come into the service. They've had a very long week. They are not so happy. But somebody's at the door. We just say, you're welcome.
Yeah.
That's enough for someone to, you know, want to come back again. Thank God we have somebody that is helping us to stand in that gap. And then we have the choir, the fire lighters, which is the intercessors, the maintenance. It has not been fully structured, but you know that we have a little need in that area. The media is very important. That's the ministry to saints. MS will be ministry to what?
Yeah.
Thank you very much, we are following. So, under the ministry to sinners, we have the evangelism team that has not been formed. The radio TV outreach, we have a radio program in case you don't know. We have a radio program by 10:15 this morning, it will be heard on Plains FM. So every Sunday by 10:15 to 10:30, we have what is called, please can I have tea? Thank you.
You need to put it up so we can share that on Facebook.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, I'll put it up. Occasionally, I put it up like that. So, during the lockdowns, we were so encouraged because Place FM marks people that goes. They can't mark. They can't keep a statistic of people that listen live, but they keep a statistic of people that visit our podcast after we minister. And during the lockdown, the first lockdown, they told us about 500 people in a month. This is our podcast.
Praise God.
Which was very, very encouraging.
Yeah.
You know, somebody just joined our church recently who the podcast brought him to the church.
Wow.
It's a Nigerian and he was for the first time listening to the podcast and he was like, so this package is in this podcast. Or this package is in this man that I can be blessed with. Praise the name of God. And he told me. I was so encouraged about it. Praise the name of the Lord. So you can help us spread the news about the podcast. And we never waste opportunity in sharing the gospel during the podcast. Praise the name of the Lord. Then we have the mission team that's not been formed. But the vision is there because it's part of ministry to sinners. Praise the name of the Lord. During the last revival service, let me share this testimony with you. During the last revival fire service, I was praying in the morning and God said to me, he said, apostolic ministry is taking the gospel to a place or a person that has not had the gospel before. And because I've seen some things in our revival fire ministry services, I've been praying before that service, and that day I spent some time to pray. And I did altar call for the first time. Thank God some of you were there. And I was so happy. About three people or four people came outside. You know what Tanya told me after the service? She told me that for the first time in a long time, What happened to her during that service has never happened to her. It's like there's a supernatural power that pushed her hand up to surrender to Jesus.
Praise God.
And I've been saying it just to remember that it's like I keep seeing a line keeping people from the altar in New Zealand. People fully yielding to Jesus Christ. So in the place of prayers, those are things that, thank you very much, that I was just feeling cold from inside. In the place of prayers, these are things that we can put to God in the place of prayer. Then we have need for healing and deliverance team. Praise the name of the Lord. It has not been fully formed, but it's part of our mission. So that it will not just go. If number one cannot do it, number three people can do it. Am I right? If three people cannot do it, who is the next? 12 can do it. If 12 cannot do it, who is the next? If 70 cannot do it, who is the next? Imagine we have 120 people that can do healing and deliverance in Christ.
Amen.
Is it about the... No, I'm just saying it.
I thought it was about the quantity.
Quality, yeah. Okay, let's go. So, beautiful place, parish, proposed structure. I just want you to have a view again.
Only for puppies.
Have a view again. Can you help us close that door? Have a view again. I can come back a little bit. Have a view again. I will listen to your feedback now. So what are the prayer points? What are the goals that we are now trusting God for? We've set this goal since 2nd or 1st year. 2nd or 1st year of our starting this church. We want to have a 50 family-based church. Definitely by the time we have 50 families, we are out of this place. Am I right? 50 families of 5 at least, 3 children and the parent will give us like 200 members. Praise the name of the Lord.
Hallelujah.
We want to have a divinely located property with commercial advantage. Let me explain myself to you. When we rented our first place, when we rented our first place, we were paying almost $2,500 per month, and we only meet on Sunday at choir practice. We couldn't even get anybody to rent it during the week. Occasionally, Nigerian community uses it. It's pure waste of money. At the time, we had to be struggling to pay the rent, and we almost shut down. So my thinking is that if we, and I need the wisdom of all of you by the time we get there, if we are going to get a property, you know we need to use it. So if we are not using it, we need to put it to commercial use for the rest of the 6 days. And it will help our mortgage. I'm thinking not like a pastor now. I'm thinking like somebody who knows about finance and accounting. So, and that kind of wisdom is very, very important. So we need not just a property that we will just come twice a week or three times a week and use, but we can use to commercial, we can put to commercial advantage during the week. Yeah, we have functional, successful ministries. And we, our vision is not just to be a Nigerian church, but to be a church of and for all nations. Celebrate Jesus. At that stage, can someone help me read Isaiah chapter 2, verse 1 to 5? Isaiah chapter 2, verse 1 to 5.
Now it shall come to pass in the latter days that the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established on the top of the mountains and shall be exalted above the hills, and all nations shall flow to it. Many people shall come and say, come and let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob. He will teach us his ways, and we will walk in his paths. For out of Zion shall go forth the law and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He shall judge between the nations and rebuke many people. They shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nations shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. O house of Jacob, come and let us walk in the light of the Lord.
Praise the name of the Lord.
Hallelujah.
So, have you refresh again? Look at the structure again. Our vision is to have ministry to strength ministry to sinners, to very strong in administrative ministry too. And then this is the detail of the ministry to saints. And this is the detail of the ministry to sinners, unsaved people. Praise the name of the Lord. Finally, what is the trigger? The trigger point. Why will you step up to do something and to function very well in these ministries? Romanian, Exodus 23, 25. Sister Tofumi, Numbers 10, 29. Emanuela, Daniel 12, verse 1 to 3. Mitchell, 1 Corinthians 15, 58.
Thank you.
Prophetic, Luke 16, 13. Thank you. Let's just read a few of those scriptures and see some things that can encourage you to do something for the Lord.
Exodus 23:25. So you shall serve the Lord your God, and he will bless your bread and your water, and he will take sickness away from you.
That's the blessing for you if you want to up your game to serve the Lord. Yeah, next, Numbers 10:29.
Now Moses said to Joshua, the son of Rur, the Midianite, Moses' father-in-law, "We are setting out in the place of which the Lord said, I will give it to you. Come with us, and we will treat you well, for the Lord has promised good things to Israel."
That's where we have that word, "Come down with us, and the Lord will do you good. For the Lord has spoken good concerning beautiful place parish." Hallelujah.
Amen.
Ruth chapter 2, verse 12. Did I give that out to anybody?
No.
Okay. If you find it, you can just read it. Luke 2, verse 12. Thy work, and a full reward be given to every one of you of the Lord God of Israel, under whose wing you have come to trust and serve him. I pray that none of you will lack full reward in Jesus' name. Mark chapter 10, verse 28 to 31. Justin, can you help us read that?
Which one's that?
Mark chapter 10, verse 28 to 31. Thank you.
Peter began to tell him, "Look, we have left everything and followed you. Truly I tell you," Jesus said, "there is no one who has left house or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or fields for my sake and for the sake of the gospel who will not receive 100 times more.
Hallelujah.
Now at this time, houses, brothers and sisters, mothers and children and fields with persecutions and eternal life in the age to come. But many who are first will be last, and the last will be first."
Hallelujah. There's a reward for you.
Yeah.
Have you heard this song before? "It pays to serve Jesus. I speak from my heart. It pays to serve Jesus." Mm-hmm. Tell the person next to you, "It pays to serve Jesus."
It pays to serve Jesus.
Hallelujah. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 58, finally.
"Therefore, my beloved brothers, be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your labor in the Lord is not in vain."
I want you to focus your mind on one thing. Whatever you do for God in this church is not for me, it's for the Lord. Do it unto the Lord. And the Lord in whom you are doing it unto will reward you in Jesus' name. See, there may be times you even feel, "Oh, does the pastor even value what I'm doing?" You know? But I may not, as human, small, may forget to appreciate what you are doing. But I want to let you know that there's a standing appreciation in my heart for every one of you. that what you are doing, in whatever capacity, I value it. And if I value it, you know that God values it. And as much as possible, I try to verbalize it. Praise the name of the Lord. But don't forget, your labor will not be vain in Jesus' name. You know what? The meaning of, sometimes when you read some scripture, you need to find out the meaning. Say Exodus 23:25 says, the Lord will bless your bread and your water, and it will take sickness away from you. It means that God will not only, when the word bless is loaded, the word bless means preserved, you will not lose your bread. The word bless also means multiply. So when God says, I will bless your bread, it means I will preserve it. Don't worry, you will not be jobless. You will not be cashless. God says, I will bless your bread and your water. It means I will preserve the source of your income. And I will not only preserve it, I will multiply it. And above all, you must keep reminding God, you must take sickness away from my life.
Yeah.
Praise the name of the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Celebrate Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Let's bow down our heads and pray. Let's just pray quickly. Just pray in the spirit. Rabashin de Rebosu Takalia. Ma Rabashin de Rebosu Kalia. Ma Rabashin de Rebe. Rabasan de la Bashin de Rebe. In the Bokuria Bashin de Rebe. In the Rabashin de Rebe. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Prophetic, can you just speak to what you have? I know you came later, but it will help us to appreciate you. Can you just speak over what we have just been taught? Quickly, sir.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for the privilege of being worthy servant in your vineyard.
Mm-hmm.
Father, we thank you because it's a rare privilege that you have found us worthy to serve.
Yes.
We appreciate that, oh God, and we're not taking it for granted. We return all the glory unto you in Jesus' name. Thank you because we are among the few who you have chosen to serve you. Lord, many are called and few are chosen. Thank you for finding us worthy. We appreciate you once again in Jesus' name. Lord in heaven, we pray that all the grace we need, all the wisdom we need, the strength, the financial support and wealth and good health that we need to serve you better, you will supply us in abundance in Jesus' name. As we keep on serving you, Lord, you will continue to chase away sickness, poverty, far away from our lives in Jesus' name. Oh, thank you for the instrument who is the shepherd over this local assembly. Pastor Charles, that you have been using to bless us. Father, strengthen him.
Amen.
Bless him and his family. Lord, increase him in wisdom to be able to lead in the right direction. Thank you, Father, because we know it is done.
Amen.
In Jesus' perfect name we pray.
Amen. Celebrate Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Before we pray, if you have any question,